questions?
David, I have a real problem with people who have prejudices against other people regardless of what it is. And I made a New Year's resolution this year that by my silence, when I allow that behavior to go on, somebody bashing gays or whatever, saying that we need to secure our borders or, you know, they should stay in their own places, that kind of talk, that I wasn't going to keep silent. And it's amazing because I made this decision at our meditation at the 4 a.m. service on New Year's Eve morning. And then just like an hour later at the breakfast table, I started to hear it. And I was like, oh my God, for one thing, I can't believe, because you said that it's a reflection of us. I can't believe that I'm at the same table with somebody that's, you know, running down the whole gamut. And then I find getting real defensive and not quite knowing how to respond. You know, and I responded, and then I said, okay, now that I've had my little say, that's all. And then I almost felt like it was somebody an apology. Because I know that where they're coming from is a place of fear. Because I believe that if somebody, you know, talks badly about gay, it's a fear that's coming up. So I guess I have a couple questions. Why am I finding myself serving, you know, with people like this? And then how do I respond eloquently without offending somebody? Because relationships are very important to me.
Yes, those are great questions. First, we'll talk a little bit about the mirroring principle. And the way that this world is set up is that in order to perceive a world, we have to believe in the world. So literally, you know, in many different traditions that call different things, you know, the Bible is that as you sow, so shall you reap. We've got the law of karma. What goes around comes around. Giving and receiving are the same. This universal law of mind has been said in many different cultures and generations. And basically, that whatever you're perceiving in the world is a reflection of what you believe. There's a cliche that's gone on for years that says seeing and believing. And then, I think it was Wayne Dyer that turned it around and wrote a book, you know, you'll see it when you believe it. And so what you're doing by receiving when you believe it is that when you change your beliefs, when you let go of ego thinking, you'll see a different world. You will not see the same world that you saw before. So in this context of what you're talking about, judgments about prejudices, judgments about different ethnic groups or cultures, countries, people, races, whatever, it's obvious that those are judgments. And you might say that the first thing to do is to start to realize that it's always your own lesson. As tempting as it is to think, okay, I'm a pretty decent, loving human being, and yet there's still these people out there going around judging everywhere, you start to realize that everything, every situation, everything you encounter is an opportunity to forgive, which is for your own mind. And that will speed up your awakening, because as long as we're thinking that we need to correct other people or we need to change the way people think, it's still out there. It's still kind of seeing it as other people are doing these things. And the question is, how do I react when these other people do these things? Instead of seeing that, if I'm still seeing these stereotypical judgments, they must still be in my mind. I couldn't even perceive them, I wouldn't even notice them unless I had a concept or a belief in mind. People would ask me about this mirroring idea. One woman said to me, she said, I don't get it. I don't understand the mirroring idea. I have a roommate. I can clean for the lady and me. My roommate is sloppy, dirty, disorganized. I don't get the mirroring here. And I said, well, start to realize that your mind is filled with a bunch of concepts that will make you cover over the light of you. And that there's this pure perfection, this pure light within you that is completely beyond all those judgments. It doesn't clean the world up into parts. Welcome. It doesn't have categories of hot and cold, fast and slow, male and female. It doesn't have categories of racial categories or cultural categories or sexual categories, you know, homosexual, heterosexual, bisexual. You start to realize that the mind is filled with a bunch of concepts and that you're going to trust this higher power of you to lead you in a state of mind where not that you stop judging, but that you see that you never had the power to judge in the first place. That a loving God would not create you with the ability to judge. And the key to what you're asking, which is really the second part, you know, like how do I practically deal with this, is that your trust level, all of our trust level needs to rise in order to let go of judgment. Because all of us have gone through educational systems and seemingly systems, family systems, whatever, that have said, you need to judge to survive. Now, here's good judgments and here's bad judgments. Here's the stuff to pursue and here's the stuff to avoid. And yet nobody has any universal agreement on what those things are. Here we go, you know, there's other cultures where they think it's okay to kill people and eat people. some of all of them, there's a commandment in that. That's not good. And there's no universal agreement on these judgments, but the more you get into listening to that intuitive self, you'll find that judgment through you rather than by you occurs. In other words, your higher self is guiding you. Call so-and-so. Go over and give them a hug. You get the little prompts that are very specific, the little indicators of things you should do. And the more you tune into that, that will guide you to this happiness. Because that's what it's all about, learning to listen to your higher self, to the spirit within, and to follow. The first aspect of forgiveness is letting it come up. So you might say that, let's say you find yourself at a breakfast table and you notice yourself getting irritated and frustrated at the conversation. That's good. The breakfast is just a backdrop that's letting you have those feelings and thoughts come up. And the more you work with this following prompts and learning to forgive, you'll find that it takes your mind into a state of non-judgment, which is really what forgiveness is. It's like letting go of all scraps of judgment in your mind. And that is really what I teach is forgiveness, is you forgive your brother, you forgive your sister for what they did not do. You don't forgive them, but come on in. So you don't think you forgive them for what they did, but you actually start to realize that it was a misperception. The way you were perceiving them was part of a darkened lens or a lens you were looking through, and you weren't seeing clearly. It doesn't matter what they seem to do in the case of like judgmental things. Well, sometimes it's the reverse. You think somebody should do something and they don't do it. And you think that they should have done something and they didn't. This is very much like the old teaching from Jesus in the Bible. You know, before you try to get the speck out of your brother's eye, get the beam or the log out of your own. Some of you have heard of my 12-step programs where they go around support groups, highlighting so-and-so that I'm an alcoholic or a drug addict or whatever. What I've been sharing with people is that try this one. Hi, my name is so-and-so, and I have a perceptual problem. It's universal. And all the support groups together and all the churches. And what that is saying that I'm not seeing the world clearly. I'm still seeing judgment acted out in front of my eyes. And it's disturbing. And what the spirit within is saying is, come on, bring it in, start to realize that you're not seeing the world clearly. And once you come to that admission that you have a perceptual problem, and you're willing to say, help, I need help to clear the lens of my mind of all this, you know, false debris, that's where the joy starts to come back. That's where the peace comes back, and by clearing that away.
Feel free to ask any questions, your heart's desire, mundane questions, spiritual questions, financial questions.
Yeah, you know, something that has always kind of intrigued me, I've struggled with it a little bit, is that, you know, it's about, you know, disengaging the judgment, backing up the judgment. However, sometimes it seems to me like there's a greater dynamic going on in terms of the way human beings encounter each other and develop and become enlightened. You know, like the young girl Rachel Corrie in Israel that stood in front of the Palestine that stood in front of that tank and got killed, or Rosa Parks, you know, the civil rights movement that refused to get up out of her seat. These people make judgments and they cause conflicts that enlighten people, that cause the bettering of humanity. And sometimes I'm confused about that, you know, like people protest wars and activist people who make judgments and get involved in social change. Sometimes it seems like there's just a bigger dynamic. There's a even within the context of this, there's judgment, and that judgment has a purpose.
Yeah, let's take a look at that, because I can certainly relate to the question. Because I was growing up, I mean, people like Rosa Parks, Gandhi, Martin Luther King, on and on, these were inspirations to me. And as I grew up, I tended to say I was not going to be a hesitant person in this world, I'm going to be an activist, and I was really an activist. I mean, and when you become active, it seems like, I mean, there's peace protests, I was active on a number of fronts, nuclear proliferation, world hunger, I mean, you can go on abortion, you can just go on and on and on. And at one point early on, I came across a line in the Course of Miracles where here's Jesus Christ in the awakened mind, and he says this line in the Course that says, seek not to change the world, seek rather to change your mind about the world. And that was definitely, especially if you're identified as being an activist. Make the world a better place, and make it better for future generations. And here's an awakened mind, saying what he said 2,000 years ago about, you know, getting the dream out of your own mind before you try to get the speck out of others. And then also I came across mystics like Peace Builder. Here's a contemporary modern mystic, so beautiful, that went around the country just wearing a little tunic and speaking wherever she'd go about peace and joy and happiness. And she came up with some striking comments. Peace Builder said that if you want to make the world peaceful, if you want to extend peace, you must be peaceful. Striking comment, considering all the peace activism and world presidents and everything. She said, you know, if you want to make friends, you must be friendly. Oh my gosh. Why have people gone on for centuries and with nothing? Teacher of joy, teacher of love. And it really struck me me that, that if I really wanted, if I really believed in peace, that I would have been peaceful. I thought, what a big hypocrite to go around protesting, telling people that you stop doing this and stop doing that. If I'm not peaceful, how much right do I have to tell somebody else what to do? There was a Gandhi one time, a great story of Gandhi. A woman came to Gandhi and said, my daughter, she just needs so much help, and would you talk to her? Or if you can't talk to her, would you just say something to tell me, to tell her? Because she loves you, she adores you, and she's got a problem. And Gandhi said, what is her daughter's problem? And she eats too much sugar. She says, eats too much sugar. And Gandhi says, Gandhi, come back and see me in a week. And she's like, a week. So she goes away, she comes back, and finally Gandhi says, tell your daughter not to eat so much sugar. No, I said, that's it. You tell your wife the whole week, and all you have to say is tell her not to eat too much sugar. And she says, what's the deal? He said, I don't eat too much sugar.
I could be sitting in the garden and reading this great book, and
after about 5 or 10 minutes, I realized that I turned the book over and I'm staring at a bird or flower or clouds or some insect walking in the grass. And it seemed to be filled with much more wisdom. It touched me deep than what I'm reading. Could you speak to that?
Yes. The best thing to think about words is that they're simple, but symbols twice removed from reality. They're very cool tools. And so I would say that when you give your mind and your heart over to your source, to your higher power, the spirit can use those words in a very helpful way when they're directed or they're reflecting this deep joy that's in your heart, these deep pieces there. But as with all spiritual paths, the words are like starting points toward meditation. Like some of you might be familiar with like guided meditations that seem to involve words or music. It can seem very helpful when you first start to train your mind to have guided meditations, visualizations, and so forth. And the deeper you go, the more that those kind of things may seem to just what happened with you now, they start to fade away. You know, you may be reading a book in the garden for 5 or 10 minutes and then all of a sudden find yourself being carried, walking up into beautiful states of mind and consciousness. And that's what you can say. You'll never be able to read the truth in a book, because truth is experience. And the experience actually cannot be described or explained. The best the words can do is kind of be like little signs over here. It's good to come in that direction. We've all had that experience. Song and vision. Just happen to turn that song on when you turn the car on. It gives you the answer to something you know more and over for 2 weeks. Wow, what a coincidence. Or a billboard or a bumper sticker on the car in front of you. Or you're walking through the library with a book falling out of the shelf. You get it. You start to realize that the spirit meets you in so many different ways. And once that starts to happen to you, you simply open your mind up and say, okay, I'm not going to try to make my spiritual journey into, like the Pharisee in the sky, making it into words or into a specific path. You actually start to feel joy and happiness, and the peace and the states of mind are your path to God. And so what you're going through God is a very natural experience.
Dream.
Yeah, we heard a Hindu chant that goes something like this: victory to spirit, victory to nature, over and over again. Victory to spirit, victory to nature. Could you speak to that?
Yes, you might say that the spirit is what reality is, and the nature part is our mental state of being. A lot of times people will associate the word nature with the birds, the flowers, the trees, and so forth. And certainly there are spiritual paths in this world that make great use of that. I think of Taoism, for example, all the beautiful metaphors of what the world calls nature, like all the streams and the rivers flowing with a sea that has no beginning or end, or metaphor of climbing a mountain, you know, that is beautiful. And all of you, I would say that the spirit and the nature are one and the same, in the sense that it's your natural state of being is to be fully present and still, with no cares, no worries, no anxiety, just perfect peace and bliss. And that's really what the chant is pointing at. It's just pointing at learning to just relax and settle into the present moment. There are many paths to God, and one of the ways we can talk about it is there's two workbook lessons in A Course in Miracles, lesson 29 and 30. In lesson 29, Jesus says, God is in everything I see. And lesson 30 is, God is in everything I see because God is in my mind. he's very careful in those two lessons to say that what he's speaking about is not ambient. It's not a God involved in this cup, or God involved in the waste paper basket, or in the chair, or in the carpet, but that there's a purpose in your mind that is placed there by God. It's like a spark of light in a darkened mind that can never go out. And that spark of light or truth is the purpose that you can so fully join with that literally will transform your whole perception of everything you see, so that you will literally see the world differently than the way that you seem to see it. You know, people have asked me about Jesus, you know, how can he be on the cross and have spikes in his arms and legs and say, forgive them for they know not what they do? You've got to have a different state of mind. state of mind, if you're going to say something like that in me. And we can say that Jesus reached a state of mind as an example, where he transcended the body and the perceptual world completely. So that he had transcended pain. He was listening to only one voice. He was not serving humanity anymore. He was just listening to the voice of God. And that he had transcended the whole concept of pain. So there was no experience of pain with Jesus on the cross. He wasn't like a martyr or a sacrificial lamb that had to pay the ransom for mankind. He was not suffering. Truly, the ego lens, the ego says that kind of hurt. From his perspective, it seemed like he was suffering, but Jesus was not suffering. We have traditions of yogis that walk over hot coals. Probably some of you who know their neighbors or friends who have gone to these ceremonies and walk on hot coals. And this was Jesus Christ. You know, he had transcended the ego of the world entirely. So that's the kind of mind game you're talking about, is to so free your mind of judgments and grievances that you reach a state of innocence where you literally have dominion over the ego's world and its laws. You literally transcend the perception of pain and suffering. What would a God of love have to do with pain and suffering anyway, you know? And would you want to have anything to do with God? If God had anything to do with pain and suffering, not me, you know, I wouldn't have much of God if God had anything to do with pain and suffering. So that's what I received early on in my experiences, was that my child, you're looking through a darkened glass, you are not perceiving accurately. You're not seeing the world clearly, and you need healing. So when I would tend to judge or blame others, this small little voice would remind me that it was my mind that needed healing. It was my perception. And I simply continued to listen to that small little voice, because that's how it really means. Joy? Okay. I'll say that's the happiness, love, you know. Those are wonderful things, and those are natural things when we learn to let go of ego thinking and ego beliefs.
I just wanted to follow up on victory spirit and victory to nature. Victory to nature seems to be like a Darwin type of approach, but nature is going someplace ever so slowly. I understand the victory to spirit in that don't lose ourselves in this game. But at the same time, you can get involved in the victory of nature. Does this make any sense to you? Can you speak to that?
Yeah, I would say that in evolutionary terms, in the end, you can't mess this up. In the sense that it's all moving back towards perfect oneness and love. It's like everything seems to be evolving to that. So I remember early Edward Martin quote, he said, there is a destiny that makes us brothers, none goes his way alone. All we send to the lives of others comes back to our own. That was sweet. It was kind of a reminder that giving this would say in terms of evolution, though, that my message is the same as Jesus. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. The kingdom of heaven is within. Right now, this very instant is the kingdom of heaven. For those that have the ears to hear, now let them hear. For those that have the eyes to see, let them see. It's right here, it's right now. It's not an evolutionary thing. In fact, the ego, or I say the error, made up time to fool you into believing that it takes time to be who you already are. And people ask, you know, what time, how long? How many lifetimes, you know? And if that was actually the case, it would be like God holding out a carrot of salvation and enlightenment saying, keep preaching. And it would be a cruel God if it actually did take time to be who you already are. That would be a pretty cruel joke. And so what I'm teaching is that enlightenment as a state of mind that is instantaneous. In fact, the only time that you can be enlightened is right now.